I'm Elex Michaelson. This week, the issue is California's Senate race with a Senate candidate and Democratic Congresswoman, Katie Porter. Then the issue is countdown to the Iowa caucuses and the official start of the 2024 presidential race. Peter Hamby of Puck News and Snapchat is here to offer insights and analysis.
Broadcasting across California, you're watching The Issue Is.
And welcome to The Issue Is. I'm Elex Michaelson. You see her standing by right there, the Democratic Congresswoman from Irvine. This week, our continuous coverage of California's U.S. Senate race. Both Katie Porter and Adam Schiff launching their first TV ads this week. Here's a quick look at Porter's.
Shake up the Senate with Democrat Katie Porter.
I'm Katie Porter, and I approve this message.
The ad highlighting her famous whiteboard and efforts to combat corruption. It began airing first in the Bay Area. Comes on the same week she told House Oversight Committee that it, quote, sucks the way they're handling Hunter Biden. Congresswoman Katie Porter joins us now from Washington. Congresswoman, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Thank you, Alex.
You launched your new plan, which is called Shake Up the Senate. Let's talk about some of the specific elements of it. You want to ban federal lobbyist contributions, ban corporate PAC donations, ban earmarks, and ban senators from trading stocks. How do you plan to pass that plan through the Senate when so many of the senators literally profit off of what you're proposing?
Well, that's exactly the problem, Alex. We have a Washington that doesn't focus on the challenges facing Californians. And that problem isn't going to get better unless we elect people who are willing to challenge the status quo, who can see the ways that big corporations and special interests are controlling the conversations in Washington.
Let's talk specifically about earmarks, which you want to ban. Basically, earmarks are specific projects that members of Congress request funding for on behalf of their constituents. Almost every Democrat supports earmarks, including your mentor and friend, Senator Elizabeth Warren. Senator Warren's website lists a long list of earmarks in Massachusetts that she's proud to support. Why is Senator Warren and so many others wrong when it comes to the issue of earmarks?
So there is a long history of these pet projects of politicians inviting self-dealing, corruption, graft. I think the important thing is that Californians should elect someone like me who's going to be a warrior for California, who's going to fight to bring resources, good, high-paying jobs in clean energy and other industries back home to California. But we want to do that all across the state. We want to do that for all Californians, not just for a handful of people or a handful of communities.
But doesn't earmarks sort of give Californians their taxpayer dollars back in a way? We're spending so much money into the system that we get projects specific to us.
Actually, Republicans actually get more money than Democrats do. And so this has actually been a longstanding problem. California only has two senators. So when you think about a system in which 100 senators from 50 states all get the same amount of earmarks, I would actually say they're shortchanging California, as opposed to dealing with a system based on what our communities need.
We are excited that you've agreed to be a part of the first TV debate of the Senate race. We want to show some info about that. We hope everybody will tune in on Monday, January 22nd from 6 to 7:30 p.m. on Fox 11 Los Angeles, KTVU in the Bay Area. I'm one of the moderators, the top four polling candidates, all confirmed to be on the stage at USC. So, Congresswoman Porter, what is your strategy for the debate?
This is a chance for me to talk about what I've accomplished in my 5 years in Congress, what makes me different, for example, that I'm the only candidate in this race, only elected official in this race who's never taken corporate PAC money, who refuses lobbyist money. I went to Washington to try to unrig a set of rules that are shortchanging Californians, and that's the message I'm going to be driving home in the debate.
You know, since we've last talked, we've seen Republican baseball legend Steve Garvey emerge. He's been climbing in the polls. Our qualifying poll has the two of you essentially statistically tied, although he's technically in the lead with the margin of error of the poll. And I'm curious, what do you make of him, of Steve Garvey, the candidate? And do you think he's a real threat to get in the top two?
I haven't had the opportunity, and I think millions of Californians haven't had the opportunity to learn anything about Steve Garvey, the candidate. The debate will obviously be a chance for us all to do that. But I'm going to be focusing on my track record of what I've done, the issues that I fight for, and what sets me apart as a candidate, highlighting accomplishments like making sure that the administration delivered free COVID testing early on in the pandemic, standing up to Big Pharma's price gouging. So, you know, I think my job in the debate is really to present my accomplishments, to present my vision for California's future, what I, as a minivan-driving mom of three school-age kids in California, what I see is what we need from Washington to be successful going forward as a state.
So to use a baseball metaphor, you didn't take the swing at Steve Garvey when you had the chance to do so there. That's interesting.
This should be a spirited debate. Yeah. This should be a spirited race. But I think it isn't. People are really tired of the partisan bickering. You mentioned earlier this week that it was a very partisan and kind of difficult week in Congress. And I think that, you know, taking sort of back and forth partisan bickering doesn't drive home to voters that the truth, which is that I understand what they really care about.
Another issue that a lot of people care about that we've seen a lot of protests in the streets over is what's happening in the Middle East right now. Another one of your competitors, Congresswoman Barbara Lee, has criticized you for not making your position clear enough. We want to put up a tweet that she sent out where she says, a conditional ceasefire is not a ceasefire at all. We need leaders who set the pace for change, not half-heartedly follow along when it's politically expedient. So just to be clear, what are you calling for? Are you calling for a permanent ceasefire from Israel in Gaza?
So a ceasefire is an agreement between the parties to a conflict to end it. That's it. That's the definition of a ceasefire. So it will require both Israel and Hamas deciding to end this conflict. And I think getting us there is going to require certain things happening. It's going to require things like freeing the hostages. It's going to require making sure that Hamas is no longer in leadership of Gaza. It's going to require a vision for a better future. I think we all should be supporting a ceasefire here, but it's not enough just to say a magic word. You have to be pushing for the conditions on the ground that bring the parties to the end of the conflict.
So you're essentially saying that you think that Congresswoman Lee has called for a ceasefire too soon.
Well, Congresswoman Lee did call for a ceasefire on the morning of October 8th at a public event that all the Democratic candidates were at. At that time, Israel was reeling from the Hamas terrorist attacks on it. And so, you know, I think that it is important to recognize that Israel, as every other nation, has a right to defend itself from terrorist attacks. And at the same time, Israel has the obligation, like every other nation in the country, to conduct war in accordance with the rules of war.
Let's end with a couple fun things, because you know we like to have fun on this show. It is award season in one of California's signature industries, entertainment. I know you don't have much time probably to watch movies. Do you have a favorite movie of the year?
I don't think I have a favorite movie, but I did just watch Beef, the Netflix series, and thought it was terrific. And it's set in California.
Okay, very nice. The last time we talked, you told us you were going to traverse the state in your minivan. We have seen that minivan up close. It is probably the most famous minivan in all of California. You recently had a landmark birthday. You turned 50. And that's something that you said publicly, so I'm not, like, breaking that news.
It's not a secret, yeah. Alex. I'm 50.
What does that milestone mean to you? And what have you learned in this past year about the state and yourself as you come up to that milestone?
Well, for me, it's been an incredible opportunity to hear from Californians across the state that while each of different community, different part of California, different region has its unique challenges, a common theme is that they do not understand why Washington isn't focused on the problems that matter to them. Why, when housing affordability has been such a hardship for California families decade after decade, does Congress not even have a housing committee working on this challenge? So I would say I think hearing and kind of across the state that the concerns that Californians have about getting Washington off its path, now decade after decade of working on doing the bidding of big corporations and focused on delivering the good high-paying jobs and ability to make ends meet, afford a home, retire securely. I think those are things that really unite Californians. And so I think that kind of commonality among my conversations with Californians, I think, has given me a very clear vision for what I want to do as California's next senator.
And what does 50 mean to you?
50 is a celebration. It's a celebration of 50 amazing years of learning, of becoming a Californian, of starting my family. And so for me, it was a happy day. It was a celebratory day. It was a day that I got to spend with my kids. I guess that's about the only benefit of having your birthday on January 3 is that sometimes it's a holiday. But it was a nice day. I went out the day before and did some whale watching off the shores of my congressional district. So it was an amazing and happy birthday.
Very nice. Well, up next, we're talking with Peter Hamby. But Congresswoman, we want to thank you for being here. And we will see you on the debate stage. But before we go, we leave you with music and a bit of a birthday wish from 50 Cent.
Go show it. It's your birthday. We're going to party like it's your birthday.
They've tried to play tough guy. You know, I'm a threat to democracy. He's a threat to democracy because he's incompetent. I mean, he's incompetent.
Former President Trump spending most of his time in Iowa attacking President Biden and not his actual competitors in the Iowa caucus. Here to talk about the official start of the presidential race this week is a veteran of many Iowa caucus nights. Peter Hamby is a founding partner of Puck News, offering insights into the intersection of Washington, Wall Street, Silicon Valley, and Hollywood. His podcast is fantastic. I try and listen every day. It's called The Powers That Be. It's free wherever you stream. He also hosts Snapchat's Good Luck America, which is needed more now than ever, even than when you came up with that name, Good Luck America. We need some luck right now. Peter Hamby, welcome back to The Issue Is.
Great to see you. Happy New Year.
Thank you. Happy New Year to you. So you have been to Iowa so many times. You traveled to Iowa not that long ago for a reporting trip. What do you make on what's happening on the ground there right now?
I have been to four straight Iowa caucuses. This is the first time I'm not going. And the reason I mentioned that, the reason I'm here with you, is the press is hyper-fixated on the drama of the Iowa caucuses and the Republican primary generally, focusing on the fight for second place between Nikki Haley and Ron DeSantis. Step back. Donald Trump is winning by anywhere from 30 to 40 points. It's just not an exciting race.
Well, and let's look at the latest poll of polls. This is Real Clear Politics, which did an average of all the polls. Mm-hmm. Trump, 54%. Nikki Haley at 17. Ron DeSantis at 15. Vivek Ramaswamy at 7. We know the media likes a good story. We know the media wants to cover this for months, right? It's good business for everybody. Mm-hmm. But does it really matter whether Ron DeSantis or Nikki Haley finishes second if they're 30 or 40 points behind?
The problem for Nikki Haley is even if she does a strong second in Iowa, she has to hope that Ron DeSantis then drops out. And then she totally has to reorganize the Republican coalition. Non-college educated voters love Donald Trump. Nikki Haley's got a lane with college educated Republicans, but that's only a small minority, maybe a plurality of Republican primary voters. Again, stepping back, the two biggest wins in Iowa history in modern memory, Bob Dole won by 12. In 1996. George W. Bush won by 10. Those were received by the press at the time as blowouts, and they ended up walking to the nomination. Bush had a scare in New Hampshire with John McCain. If Trump wins by 30, 25, that's the biggest Republican blowout in Iowa in modern memory. And yet, the press loves a horse race. We want this to be a contest, and that's why, you know, they're sort of over-investing in covering this, the drama of this primary.
And part of the fun of reporting in Iowa, say, versus a place like California, is the whole feel is like you're in a living room with 12 people and it's cold and you're all hanging out and it's like a different level of access than you get here.
Yeah.
But when you have Donald Trump, whose name ID is 100%, and you have Joe Biden, whose name ID is 100%, does the media matter like it used to?
Again, that's a reason I was hesitant to go out just for the final few days before the caucus this cycle. Even right now, the wind chill in Iowa is like negative 20 degrees. Several candidates, Nikki Haley, Vivek Ramaswamy, have canceled events, and they're doing virtual town halls. So they're not even in the living rooms and the pizza ranches and the church basements where they usually campaign before a caucus. But that's also reflective of what politics and campaigns are now. They're on your screens increasingly. The issue set is nationalized. So yes, if you're a lower tier candidate, you're a reporter, you go out, you can stick a mic in their face, get a quote, get some cool interviews with voters. That's always the most important thing, talking to voters. But politics is just so nationalized now in the Trump era, and it's not just because of him. He capitalized on that. It just makes it less valuable to be in the room with candidates at campaign events. Again, still think it's worthwhile talking to voters sure. and getting out there. But Iowa is just one state out of 50. There's a long way to go. Maybe there's a short way to go if Trump wins by a whole lot. But, you know, I'll probably go to New Hampshire or South Carolina. But I took a pass on this one.
Meanwhile, Joe Biden. Is already sort of starting to run against Donald Trump. Donald Trump starting to run against Joe Biden. What do you make of where Joe Biden is at right now?
Well, in the polls, not great. Their whole theory of the case is keep calm and carry on. It's too early to talk about a head-to-head matchup in the election. Once there's a choice on the ballot in November, then people will come to realize we can't go back to Donald Trump, even if Biden is flawed. There are some problems with that. I mean, Biden, people really, really don't like Biden. Core Democratic constituencies, young people, black people traditionally, Hispanic folks, they're not coming home to Joe Biden right now. There are going to be possibly third-party candidates, Cornel West, RFK Jr., Jill Stein, on a variety of
Joe
swing
Manchin,
state ballots.
Maybe?
Exactly, Joe Manchin. And there, that all of those people possibly could suppress the Democratic vote. And Biden only beat Trump in these swing states, Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Arizona, by a few hundred thousand votes. And if people decide to stay home because they're not enthralled with Biden, it's a tough lane, but this election was always going to be close. That's what the Biden White House says. But I do think that the only person Joe Biden could beat right now is Donald Trump, because he is more polarizing, more unpopular.
All right, Peter is sticking around to talk about California politics, that big California Senate race. We go to break. Reminder not only to listen to his podcast, Powers That Be, but also our podcast. Search for The Issue Is wherever you stream for extended interviews with all of our guests, including Peter, on demand for free anytime. We'll be right back with more of The Issue Is.
This election is a choice between results or just rhetoric. Californians deserve a senator who's going to deliver for them every day.
That's Congressman Adam Schiff's first TV ad of the race. He and Katie Porter focusing on women in the Bay Area with their first ad buy, both exclusively advertising in the Bay Area. Back with us right now is Peter Hamby of Snapchat and Puck News. Let's talk more about California's Senate race. As we've mentioned, we're hosting the first TV debate of the race. It's on January 22nd at 6 o'clock. The top four polling candidates will be there. And we got a new poll out this week from the LA Times and Berkeley IGS. It shows Adam Schiff at 21%. Katie Porter, who we talked to earlier, at 17%. Steve Garvey, the Republican businessman, Dodger legend, at 13%. Congresswoman Barbara Lee at 9%. How do you see the state of the Senate race right now?
First of all, was Schiff doing that ad in front of at a winery? Those barrels of wine? I was looking at these poll results this morning, looking under the hood, just like you. It feels like Adam Schiff has put together something of a coalition so far. Obviously, he's the most famous candidate. He goes on MSNBC and CNN all the time. He's famous from all the Trump wars. He's raised a ton of money. But he's beating Katie Porter and Barbara Lee among women, for example. Across the board, his numbers among a variety of subgroups are just better than the rest. The other thing I noticed was that Katie Porter's number since the last poll is just flat. If you look at the LA Times online, they do a graphic. It's kind of nice. I love a nice graphic.
Yeah.
Katie Porter, since last poll, just a straight line at 17%. Mm. No growth. And then Steve Garvey, he wasn't even in the race by when they did the last poll. He's also gone up. Again, that's probably because Republicans are looking for somebody to come home to. But, you know, that TV ad, Katie Porter, Barbara Lee, Steve Garvey, they've all got to go on TV. That's how you win campaigns. That's how you change minds in California. And we haven't seen a lot of that yet. So, and then there's also the debate that you're moderating coming up. Those are going to be big opportunities for, I think, Katie Porter to really start to shake this up. Because if Steve Garvey gets in that second place position for the runoff, you know, it's Schiff versus Garvey. Schiff's got, we think, a straight shot to the Senate after that. And Katie Porter is out. So she's got to hold Steve Garvey down while also pulling Schiff down too.
Meanwhile, the other big statewide political story of this week was Governor Gavin Newsom unveiling his budget. He says the state's deficit is $38 billion, not $68 billion, what the legislative analyst says. Just broadly speaking, though, of Gavin Newsom, who obviously gets so much national attention, a lot of your folks, the rest of the country probably ask you about.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you see Gavin Newsom right now?
You know, if you look at polls of potential Democratic candidates in 2024, 2028, you've got Biden, you've got Kamala. Gavin Newsom is usually number three, you know, above people like Pete Buttigieg and Elizabeth Warren, who have run before. And it's because he's done a good job both as a Biden surrogate, punching at Republicans. He did that debate with DeSantis. But going into other states and making the case that California just does things better. The flip side of that is people think Gavin Newsom is, you know, a slick socialist from California who's spending too much money on every program, which is maybe what that budget reflects.
Peter, we love having you here. Thank you so much for your perspective. It's great speaking with you.
It's great to be here and not in freezing cold Des Moines.
Exactly. It's the place to be. We go to break. Speaking of Governor Newsom, with his announcement of the latest class of the California Hall of Fame this week, there are 17 different names, including former San Francisco Mayor Willie Brown, Ava DuVernay, the great filmmaker. It's a wide-ranging group that also includes the Go-Go's. So we go to break with their music. Take it away. Next week on The Issue Is, Democratic candidate for the U.S. Senate, Barbara Lee. We'll also talk with Republican candidate for the U.S. Senate, Eric Early. And catch up with retired four-star general, David Petraeus. Also next week, I'm honored to be co-moderating a debate in the race for L.A. County District Attorney. D.A. George Gascon will face off against nine of his challengers on stage. You can watch myself and co-moderator John Regardi on L.A. Magazine's website on Thursday at 6 p.m. and to lamag.com. Thank you so much for watching The Issue Is this week. We leave you with this beautiful shot of my favorite place, California coast. We're flying over Marina Del Rey. See you next week.